Many long years ago, a great tumult came to the world of men. The kings of Middle-earth fell into battle. Great warriors of the English, the Vikings, and the Norman were cut down, not just in the fields beyond Hastings, but in three almighty battles. And our land, England, would never be the same again. These terrible events of the year 1066 were woven into a tapestry fit for a king. But these threads speak only of conquest through the voice of a conqueror. If you look more closely, you will see a different story. Not of the highborn, but of the ordinary men of our shire. Is the story of all Englishmen who laid witness to the darkest year of our times. There was once a time when Europe was ruled by great warriors, divided by their lust for power, but united by their prize. To conquer England would shatter the harmony of Europe, enrich and glorify the victor, and change forever the lives of ordinary people. None more so than the villages of England's peaceful shires.
Ich die Gieva meines der Torres Jura, and ich die Gieva Hera Viales Charu.
Nim min hond, wasind hand festa, wasind wear am weef.
Kiss her here!
Kiss her here! Kiss her here!
Kiss her then.
Love to your spirit.
Love to your spirit, too.
Orgar, is it you?
It is, Lerfic.
Welcome home.
You know me. You know why I come.
Lord!
Today is the day. I can't help what you've chosen to do with it. The weapon men shall line up here. The white man shall sit. The white man shall sit. Today, the war band turns over. But the weapon man I took last time will not be coming back. These fresh men I must take to join them. You go to your homes, collect your shield and your spear. And you sit down. You. Those who have none, those who are young, will be given new weapons.
Why do you keep the men? Why do you take more? Where will we get our grain when the hunger comes at Eastertide?
If I do not take these men at this time, you shall none of you have stomachs to feel hunger. Sit down. You two go to your home. There are some moments before we move on. Where is that lair, Frithjof?
Just a farmer.
Well, now you are to be a soldier.
No, I'm no soldier.
I have had you not in my war band before. You would have been better off had I caught you last time.
Really? How so?
That will be work this time. As we are taught and bidden, friends, I swear before this company that I shall fight to the death for my king. If my king or my lord shall die, I shall take his place and fight as he would have fought. If any man here see me taken with weak heart and run away, he shall remind me of this pledge made here before my kin. It's time.
What matters you, child? What you see?
The warrior Sea King is coming west to fill England's graveyards. Black birds of carrion follow. Death comes.
It was always custom for a handful of our weaponed men to be called for the war band. But this late summer was different. The huscarls of the king took what seemed like every farmer, every drover, every beekeeper from all over the forests of our shire. This new king, whom they called Harald, must surely have heard the portents of doom as we had done. They say a long-tailed star blazed across the sky when first he came to the throne. They spoke of his enemies across the Whale Road, who meant to invade our lands and unseat him.
Christ almighty. You take this solemnly, then?
They're coming. When the wind is right for them, the Norman will come under cover of dark. And in the dawn, there'll be nothing but ash.
England found herself a vulnerable kingdom in this year, 1066. The old King Edward, known as Confessor, had promised England to many cousins around the Empire of the North Sea in exchange for a peaceful death. Harald, of no royal blood, stood closest to the deathbed and took the crown for himself. We feared that jealous armies forged their weapons and waited for the wind to blow them across the Whale Road. From Normandy, from Flanders, from Denmark. But the greatest danger of all came from the warriors brave men feared the most, the Viking Earl. From the land of the fjords.
Okay, Vina. Yeah, it'll be good. Det er nemlig rigtigt. Er vi helt sikre, når vi kommer til England? Hvad er det så, vi vil? Ja, det er nemlig rigtigt. Vi er også roer, men hvad er det, vi vil? Vi vil nemlig kæmpe, ja, vi vil. Hvad er det, vi vil?
Much was told us about the lands of the Vikinger, where the soil was poor and the air was cold. Little wonder that its hardened warriors looked upon England as a land of plenty and willingly answered any call to arms.
Þú ert mörgum kostum búin.
do not dream. I was laid on a stony earth. That's all. I must lead them to the boats.
You make sure he comes back, brother.
I will.
You make sure.
I will.
Make sure.
The first time England had readied itself to face this northern terror.
And remember, hold fast next to your brother. Go!
The Vikinger had long ago come in wolf packs from every crevice of their coast, and they had wreaked a whirlwind of destruction that did not bode well for the unready men of our shires. In their journey that summer, the Vikinger rode 300 miles across open sea. 200 ships cut past Shetland and Orkney, gathering more ships as they sped, past the land of the Scots, whose king had lately killed Macbeth. For the Vikinger prize lay further south, the greatest bounty in all Middle-earth.
On the whale road. I thought I saw a lantern on the water.
Oh, God. The Northmen, are they not men like ourselves?
They're not men like ourselves.
Poor farmers of Crowhurst, how could you have known? as you stood guard in the south expecting a Norman invasion. The Vikinga made surprise landfall hundreds of miles to the north.
And do not attack us. We want merely to trade. The Vikings are learning to trade. You must listen to us, English. Just listen to us, English. We are learning to trade. But some of us are rather slow.
While the Vikinga brutalized the unguarded settlements of the northern shores, the south coast basked in the safe knowledge that the Normans had dared not come. Perhaps they were afraid of our brave weaponed men. Perhaps they were simply not favored by the sailing winds. In any case, fighting season was almost over, and the harvest was due. The time had come to stand the farmers down.
I will not be on the warband again for another year.
Be on before nightfall.
Indeed. He to a loathsome bride, and I to a honeymoon in the ham.
Is there still the great circle of oak trees in the forest by Crowhurst where the children climb?
There is.
I should like to climb those trees again.
Dad, don't worry about it. Just little boys charging around. Tell you what, I'd like to see him try and climb a tree, yeah? With an head big as that, huh? Huh? Ow.
Up! Your wives and your harvest will have to wait. Take up your weapons again.
And so our new king faced a terrible choice. Should he leave the southern shores unprotected from an enemy that might yet arrive with a change of wind? With fighting season over, the king chose the invader already on our shores over the one that may never come. It was a choice that would seal the fate of Crowhurst and of all the villages of England. After ravaging the settlements of the northern coast, the Vikinga took to their boats again. If only they were setting a northerly path home. But no. They turned inland, heading upriver into the dark interior where the great Vale of Jorvik lay. Thank you. The sagas record that the Vikingar met their first resistance at Fjolford on the Wednesday before the Feast of St. Matthew.
A great seafarer sent me, gifted with foreign language as I am, to tell you that they will let you give silver and animals in exchange for peace. I believe it's better for you to buy off our radiant tribute than we should cut you down. We do not wish to fight. We just want to make a bargain.
A bargain? We will give you tribute. Our swords and spears and a thin smile of the war axe. I have two great earls with me with their men. Tribute. We will defend this land to the last ditch. Now pick up your dead animal and go.
I'm so sad to hear that.
Cattle die. Kindred die. Every man is mortal. But I know one thing that never dies, and that is the glory of the dead. With God's help, what is it that we want?
The glory!
You want?
The glory!
Soldiers and farmers gathered by the northern earls did not lack for courage. They could have shivered behind the walls of York, but they chose to take arms and face the strong invader across a ditch. To defend the honor of their wife men and the freedom of their children, they risked life and limb. Insults and spears were slung. The men of York probing for weakness in the Viking shield. Once the name calling could be borne no longer, the real battle would surely follow. The Battle of Fulford was the first of three battles in that fateful year. The English strategy was simple and brave: to pierce, if they could, the Vikinger line in the center and thus caused panic and a fracturing of their ranks. But the Vikinga were the best trained warriors in the known world. Fighting in small deadly bands, driving the poor farmers like sheep to their slaughter. Again and again, the fearless English hurled themselves at the foreign giants until they broke the Viking line. This only favored the Vikinger. They were merciless killers whose strength grew in the madness of the battle. They knew too well how to go berserk. Many of those who dreamt of their death were to fall that day, but not the Vikinger. Death belonged to the men of York. Because they had been lured into a trap conceived by the Norse king Hardrada. He had drawn the poor, unwitting English into his middle so he could cut them down from behind their backs.
The Vikinger have come, Greenbeard. You should have paid with something less dear.
News of the agony of Fulford had spread throughout England. Now the men of Crowhurst knew what awaited them. Covering 200 miles in only 4 days, King Harold's trained huscarls and untrained farmers closed the ground on the invaders in the north. Harold was a famed warrior. As an earl, he had wreaked destruction on the Welsh 3 years before. But as king, this was his first great test. And so much would depend on this army of the south, now strung across the forests of Middle England as they headed up country.
Seriously, my legs are gonna fall off in a minute.
Oh. You have the choice. Either shut up and save your breath, or drop dead.
You were ever a bully, Ordgar.
You were ever a whining little shite. 'Tis wondering to me we share the same grandfather.
I wasn't meant for marching. Just leave me here.
I am bound to provide every man and boy a fighting body. Can you stand?
Just.
Here, you collect this shield. I hope you heal swiftly. You shall all need your feet when we reach the north.
Yeah, if we ever reach the north, that is. You don't die on the way there.
We'll not die on the way.
Why am I carrying all this stuff?
The Vikinger conquered the north with such ease that Hardrada, their king, chose to split his army into parts. One third would guard the ships at Riccahal, while the remainder would camp for the winter near York by Stamford Bridge, all enjoying the spoils of war.
Our army, 2 out of every 3, stay here to wait the hostages. I will take some men and weapons back to guard the fleet.
It's no fate for a brave captain. I will go.
Geert, I'm of no use just now. Snorri the Skald gave me good herbs, but they must work their work. You will take the Hardrada's commands from now.
The Vikinger have won. The North is fallen. This is the greatest campaign the Vikinger have ever fought. We will flourish with England's riches.
Often and again, through God's grace, man and woman usher children into the world. They cherish them and teach them as the seasons turn until their young bones strengthen, their young limbs slowly lengthen. Now only God knows how the coming years will use the growing children. One will die young, bringing grief to his family. Hunger devour one. Storm shall dismast another. One will be spear slain.
You, we don't watch it.
Elves.
Don't say that.
Always in the woods, there are elves.
What did I just say?
They will steal your shadow and pour madness into your ears as you sleep.
As well, we don't sleep then.
They will cut out your heart as well.
Reveal yourself, elf! Reveal yourself!
I am no elf. You are not elves neither. Who are you? We are the Weapon Men of the West. We heard the war call, and we come to fight for the king against the invaders in the north.
How many are you?
As many as we could be. More come on the pathways. Many more.
And we bring wife men. Wife men who are not our wives.
Wife man who are not our wives. You hear?
Yeah.
Join us and rest. Welcome. We march hard.
Welcome.
Make room for our brothers. Bring mead. Welcome. Here, let's have more of your poem. And let's talk of death.
I'm Alfred. Look, you're not fearsome. Do you have some bread?
No. No, but I have a wife, man.
One child, by God's grace, will overcome all the hardship that bedeviled his youth and achieve happiness in old age. You receive riches. Treasure. And the mead cup.
Yeah!
From his people. As much as any man may own in his lifetime. I have something for you.
Oh, there's the cure, what is that?
Tis bread! Here's one. So, I am a strange creature, for I satisfy women. Yeah? I grow all tall and erect in a bed, and I'm all hairy underneath. From time to time, a beautiful girl may dare to grip me by my reddish skin, pop me in her pantry and rob me of my head. And all at once, I make her eyes water. Huh? What could I be?
An onion.
An onion, thank you, Ordgar.
Anybody here know these hills?
I do. These are my lands, I know the lay of them.
You? The Vikinger are beyond Jorvik.
Well, then the Derwent lies between us and them.
A fish road. And what bridges are there?
Stamforth a brigge. Small, wooden, over those hills.
After 5 days on the road, our small band of weapon men came finally to the Derwent, a little downstream from the bridge at Stamford. In this place, King Harald had amassed a mighty force of fighting men. But somewhere in the forests beyond, so indeed had the Vikinger.
Maybe we should go back.
We swore an oath that if we were taken by weak heart, we would remind each other of that oath.
And are you reminding me of it?
I suppose so.
Do you wish me to remind you of it?
Yes.
Fine, I remind you of your oath.
Christ almighty, they're so close. They're like dragons, they're enormous.
But we are fleet.
Indeed. Which is very helpful in running away. We have to kill him. We've got to kill him or it would bring the old camp on us.
You do it.
You do it.
Let's both do it.
Run to safety, farmers of Crowhurst, for the next time you meet the Vikinger, there will be blood. The Battle of Stamford Bridge would seal the fate of two kingdoms, but bring no respite from the greater war. For a new predator would spring its lair, invading England's unprotected shires and destroying every living creature who resisted its advance.
Has passed, as he fleets.
Many long years ago, a great tumult came to the world of men. Our Middle Earth was invaded, not once, but twice in the same year. The first war took the weaponed men far from their wife-men and their homes. To do battle against the Vikingr up in the north. Much blood was shed. And now the destiny of England would hang on a battle for a bridge. But little could these brave warriors know that far away, a second predator would land on English soil and bring terror to the unprotected villages of the south. These tragic events of the year 1066 were woven into a tapestry fit for a king. But these threads speak only of conquest through the voice of a conqueror. If you look more closely, you will see a different story. Not of the highborn, but of the ordinary men of Middle-earth. Is the story of all men of Europe who laid witness to the darkest year of our times. The sagas tell of a peaceful morning in the two Viking camps. One in three basked on the shores of the Humber, guarding the fleet. Miles away, encamped around Stamford Bridge, two in three collected their booty from the conquered villages of northern England.
I want that horse.
To appease the Vikinger, the unhappy people of Yorkshire brought their harvest, their livestock, even their children. Their surprise. They had trapped the Viking army while the invaders were under strength and pinned them to a single bridge.
Now we stay very small.
I've killed deer. I'm good at it. But I've never done this before. Have you?
Outnumbered by the English at Stamford Bridge, the Vikingo were desperate for reinforcements. But their brothers would have to run 15 miles in full armor to play their part. And yet, all that effort might be in vain if the two sides could agree to divide the kingdom.
He's offering them land. We hope he's leaving them the north entirely. Many good Englishmen who cannot be reborn or regrown will die here today. We need those men in the south.
You said fighting season was over. That is what you said.
Does it look to you like it is over now?
Words between kings came to naught. So the Vikinger chose a champion to hold their foe at bay.
I will do it.
God be with you, friend.
We do not need God on a day like today.
We need Odin.
Cattle die! Kindred die! Every man is mortal, but I know one thing that never dies, and that is the glory of the dead. With God's help, what is it that we want?
To glory!
What?
To glory!
What's the matter? You afraid of them? Yeah.
Yeah!
You will have to go to the bridge. You're crafty, I hear, and a good climber.
You do want me to go to the bridge?
I am bidden to offer terms to your lords. We will accept your surrender.
Skald.
Arnarina is a gottur.
Do you understand? We wish no more death here. I respect you, brave warrior. I do not wish to kill you.
Skald, that is the India that only phalanx is Zulun.
And how can come in? Then, English, there is to be no end. I am to keep this bridge!
I respect you, brave Viking. I'm sorry for my stealth. It does me no credit. Go to your great gods.
Men of England, now you had your prey in full sight. that you would need to make your kill swiftly, because other Northmen came at speed towards you and towards the clash that would decide the fate of Middle-earth. The Battle of Stamford Bridge went far beyond the bridge itself. All over the forest, skirmishes raged throughout the day. Now was not the time to be seized with weak heart before the mighty Hardrada and his Raven of Doom.
Where's that small man who was married in Crowhurst?
Here he is. His name is Tophi.
Drink, Tophi.
Onto the roadways to give comfort for bread.
No.
Run. Run with all your heart.
I never thought to die in the flatland of the West. You'll have to go back to the fjords now.
I will, lead man. I will take you home.
I wish you to kiss my son for me. He is born. I can see him. You must tell our saga to him. And you will tell it to his sons. He will be Viking.
Of the 300 Viking ships that landed in England, only 24 returned. We did not know it then, but the age of the Vikinger was over. But at what cost? So many thousand brave men of England had fallen within a single week. Who could not be regrown or reborn for the greater war that might lie ahead. A war that would threaten more than just the crown.
They've come out of fighting season. They've landed in Sussex.
Sussex?
Up with you! We march now!
Was this ever they'd come? Whisper of Sussex!
Honey! I don't see it!
Les hommes. Où sont les hommes?
Non, c'est un enfant.
Où sont les hommes? Baron de Croton, demandez où sont les hommes.
Where are the fighting men? Where are the men?
In the north.
Auprès de Vétillier-Tonor, dans le temps de Moisson.
Why are the men north?
To fight the Viking, or all the weapon men are in the north.
Merci.
Merci. Congo, have good men! Punishment for the cheating ways of your king. Of your huskals and the man who deserted you. They have come to fight a Vikinger. It is likely they have come for good. Would you like my English, mon baron?
Sorrow for the wife men of Crowhurst, but pity also their weaponed men. So far from fighting off the Norman invaders who possessed their village, and now so few. The army of King Harold was strung across the northern forests, many taking leave of breath and falling from exhaustion. So desperate for fighting men were the English that they admitted into their war band any man willing to fight for food or silver, no matter their previous allegiance.
We rest here!
We are your cipher, Tom.
I am at rest.
More Viking will come.
We need more than those. We need the winter to rest.
Where's your king?
I ain't heard this past 2 nights. I hope he rides for more men.
You hope?
Oh, God. We rested.
We cannot run. As we ran north, the road has turned arse. We must gather our strength and stop pestering.
What of Crowhurst?
Crowhurst is a village of 5 families. Engeland is a country.
At least let me go.
We shall not win this battle by allowing the few men we have to go searching after their kin. I'm sorry.
Perfect. Please.
We're marching! Oh, come on! Come on, move on! Come on! You can do it! Come on! Come on! Come on! Come on!
So, who was this enemy laying waste to England's southern coast? They had come from across the Wales Road, from the dark shores of Normandy, and gave us such night fears, they were known to us as orcs. Curse had been many months in its casting. A blessed crusade in the name of the Pope. The Norman Duke William believed himself to be the rightful king of England, promised thus by the noble Harold, sworn over holy bones, so the Normans say. When Harold took the crown for himself, William commanded his shaven-headed knights to bring their horses to the sea.
Oh, that's what they go!
Few had ever sailed before. Most could not swim. Horses and men would make bad sea fellows.
Thank you.
have always defended this Isle of Middle-earth gave rough passage to the Orca fleet. If only those winds had sent more ships to the bottom of the Whale World, where they belonged. But God, for reasons only he knows, chose to spare them. One by one, the orcish vessels came over the horizon. The pestilence had landed. Scattered all along the undefended cliffs and dunes of our blessed England. And now you know what was to become of our little village of Crowhurst, perched on the road from the sea to Hastings.
This is a message to your king, Utgard.
I want this body shell of a wife, man, seen by every weapon man here. This is what we must fight! You go south, Bar. You go south and see to your village.
No. This is cunning. They've sent these white men here to angle you into battle ahead of time.
Go south. Take this horse with you. Leofric, remember you are a Huskar. Go with him.
Oh, God.
Go!
And if you find Crowhurst, and if any yet still live,
take the white men to the priory. The Norman must respect the walls of solitude. And find whichever man you can, and tell him we come in great number, but we need more. Go!
Do you not know which way Crowhurst lies?
We will find it.
Take the road that brings the fish. The one that rises up and falls down again before you smell the salt.
You will know your village by the smell of ash.
The Norman orcs had sent a message to all weaponed men. What were our brave warriors to do but fly in rage towards their homestead, little caring that the Normans lay like wolves in wait for their prey?
Come on, come. Just leave it!
Come on, come on.
Tophie!
Sophie, just come on!
This was once my father.
Judith.
Judith! Judith!
I have sorrow for you.
How many days since I was hand fasted?
3 weeks? I don't know.
Our lives have come. Our lives are gone.
They do this? They do such things as this in the name of the Christ? Bastard! Orca! Bastard! Who's there?
Weapon man of this shire, show yourself. I said, show yourself.
Oh, child. Child. Merciful Lord. Child, what befell here? Where are the wife men? Child, listen. I know you. Your name is Elf. You were born 10 days after the swallows flew back. I know you. I am your friend. You can tell me what happened here. What did you see?
Warrior Sea King has come as defend England's graveyards. words of Karen follow. Death comes.
You are safe. Now you are safe. Keep warm. I promise you, no sword shall harm you. No Norman will come for you. I am a Huskarl of this village, and I swear I will keep fear from you. I swear.
I have not even anger. If I had anger, my soul would have strength of purpose. I have no anger.
Oh, I have anger. I have enough anger for the two of us.
They took the wife men.
They took the wife men live? Where did they go? Do you remember?
The forest road.
Now, just one day's march away, the stragglers that formed King Harald's army were gathering numbers every hour. Spirits, they say, were strengthening. More weapon men were promised every day from Kent, from Anglia. The sooner these orcs were found, the sooner they could be driven back into the Whale Road whence they came. And so scouting parties were summoned to track the vermin down.
Ha! Good morning!
We're moving on. Bring the wife, man. She's proved herself fit and well built.
Yes, she has.
We must find the Norman under cover of dark.
And what do we do when they're found?
Kill him while they sleep.
It's not honorable to kill them while they sleep.
We should cut them while they sleep. So with their last blink of the eye, as you hold them by the hair, slice off their balls and feed them to the pigs.
Feeding the pigs, dirty Viganger bastard.
There are men here.
What?
There are men here. I know this.
Stop! These men!
Sentries.
There are sentries are posted in trees, Aram. Hiding their nuts like squirrels.
Are there more?
Now we shall find out from this one.
Oh. Tail, it's
There are greater of them than the War of the Viking. He says they're building. He says they mean to stay.
They meant to stay indeed. And they meant to breed. And they would destroy every creature of English birth who would not accept them as overlords. So, men of England, to defend your homes and hold off these orcish invaders, were you prepared to fight the third and greatest battle of them all? The memory of which to this day is hard to bear. Ago, a great tumult came to the world of men. Our Middle Earth was invaded, not once, but twice in the same year. The first war took the weaponed men far from their wife men and their homes to do battle against the Vikinger up in the north. Much blood was shed before the English brought down the mighty Norsemen. But then, before the victory cup could be tasted, news came of a second enemy to the south.
Up with you! We march again!
The Normans have come!
Brave men of Sussex, where were you when you were needed so keenly? Now you would have to run the whole length of England to fight a second war against the Normans and hold a hill near Hastings from a duke who would be conquered. These terrible events of the year 1066 were woven into a tapestry fit for a king. But these threads speak only of conquest through the voice of a conqueror. If you look more closely, you can see the little people of our Shire who fought against him and his killing breed.
We'll be right back.
is the story of all Englishmen who laid witness to the darkest year of our times. After landing in England, the Norman orcs had pulled back from their village burning and were now fortifying a peninsula of our beloved Sussex. Duke William had sent out orders to destroy the rest of their ships so they could not return to their homeland. These orcish invaders intended to make England their own. And they would destroy any creature who stood in their way.
I've heard, far from here, way over to the west, there's a place without equal, rightly renowned. Few men reach this remote corner of Middle-earth, but the land there is so lovely, endowed with delights.
I do.
You will be safe there. I give you my word. Is she of your kin?
She's the wife of a Norman who has sat by and watched us. Please kill her. Kill her.
Run! 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 Come on! Come on! Forgive me, I must see the trial. Go that way! That way! Go! Run!
told you we should not accept the women alive.
It was a good plan. It kept the men from mutiny.
It was against orders.
Your lust for blood makes me sick.
Kill you while I breathe. They will not know. Come on, run! Frank! Frank! He's but a child. Child! Take me, not the child.
Go. Go!
For you.
Silver and gold may make us bold and bind our jewels together, but love will stay till we are old and weary of endeavor.
What was done? Judith?
We must find Duke William and the rest of our army.
They will be south of here.
There will be battle at last.
Good.
I doubt you have the guts for it, mon baron. You let that huskarl go, and that child. You disobeyed. Your child will pay the price of your disobedience. As Drogo did. For his fathers.
Although the invaders were our cruelest enemies, it should be known that not all of them were cast in the same mold. But then the Orca were never only of one tribe. The Normans had pressed men of Brittany and other neighbors into their holy war, offering promises of land and taking families hostage.
No!
I will call for you, my love. There will be great forests in England to run through, and great rivers to fish. Your mama will cry, but you must dry her tears for her.
Chevalier Duzouf, you will see to it she is fed and served as befits a Breton noblewoman.
Duke William would wish it.
My Breton friend, I do not take kindly to instructions.
Sister Solitude, bring this child to join the sisters and the wife men. Will you keep this child in your care?
I'm sorry. We have too many here.
Sister, this is a child.
We have too many here already. I am sorry.
I am a Huskarl of the Royal Guard. Now open this door.
We do not open our doors to instructions from soldiers. That's why you brought your wife men here.
You are right. Accept my apologies. We will leave you in peace.
Wait. These women are noble, good women of the town, good wives, fine daughters. They've been arriving here every hour and every day for the last 7 nights. We've seen things here that we've never dreamt of seeing. Men may do such things that women would never dream of.
What can be done?
We soothe them as we can. Many will not take meat and choose to die of hunger. Many no longer speak.
See?
Sentinels.
Coutons.
Debout.
What is it?
Stuart. Chevalier,
hein?
Chevalier.
Il n'y a pas froid du vin, c'est là. Attention du vin. Où là? Ok. Où est-ce que tu peux? Qu'est-ce que c'est? Là. Viens par là. Quoi? Oh, 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 oh. Viens par là. Qu'est-ce que c'est que ça?
Anglais,
il y a des Anglais.
À droite, à droite,
à ta droite,
à ta droite, à gauche, à gauche, à gauche.
Retreat.
Allez.
I will not retreat from these Christmen. I will not retreat. Encerclez-les. Encerclez-les.
Attention, derrière, derrière, derrière toi.
Comment le côté. They say they are surrounding us.
Yes.
If we don't go now,
we'll
be trapped. Retreat!
Wake up. I met a party of men from Anglia on the road. We go to the hill at Hastings. Come, your wife man will be safe.
No, I've done my war work.
Look. You mind the days beyond the battle, new husband, when you must tell your kin that you sat in a high tower and watched England burn.
I will stay with my wife man.
Go with him.
No.
The battle will be swift. We'll rebuild our house.
Don't be long.
So the English of the hill. We have God.
Thus the battle lines had been ordered. The Normans massed below the hill upon which the English stood proud. And behind that hill called Senlac, lay the Norman prize, the green and bounteous fields of England. Battle clash of 1066 had begun. The hail of arrows upon the shield wall failed to shatter its strength or draw the English down from the hill. Now it was time for the weapon most fated and most feared in the Norman armory, the one brought at such cost across the Whale Road.
To death. Why do they stand on the hill? Why do they not fight? We need a champion. The Duke will wish a challenger to draw out the English in single combat.
That's your gesture of commitment. We'll bring you rich reward.
Not me, mon baron. Our champion must be a man of noble birth.
Why? Make sure the Duke knows who I was.
And who are my kin in Frost?
That'd be me.
Me win, English.
Speak slower.
Oh, let me appear valiant. My family will live, even if my soul will not.
Unexplained, yet noble sacrifice the Norman victor would make that morning. Perhaps both men of rank shared a common goal. Both, in different ways, had died so that others could live. Of your shire. Every Englishman who shared your oath vowed to avenge your untimely death. Let the Norman orcs come, as surely they would, on horse, on foot, en masse.
Okay!
Kjellborg!
After wave of Norman assault still could not take Ironhild. The Duke, who would be conqueror, they say, was somewhere in the thickest of the fighting. And then, such is the confusion of battle, a rumor spread amongst the groans of the dying.
The Duke is dead.
He's slain. Pass it on.
The lead man is dead.
Pass it on.
The Duke is dead.
Oh, how sweet the taste of victory must have been. How bitter for the Norman invaders.
Let's drive them into the sea for Arthur!
No, no, no!
Come on, they flee!
Do not break the wall!
Battle is done!
Do not trust the Norman! Do not break that wall!
What had seemed like a retreat revealed itself to be a trick to lure the English from the safety of the hill. Duke William was not dead. And for the first time that day, the Norman horsemen could harness their deadly advantage. So many Englishmen met their doom below the hill. None more beloved than the cowardly farmer who became a huscarl and saved my life. A Norman trick had taken too many from us, leaving few weaponed men to stand alone at the fateful Battle of Hastings. Which brings us to the plight of the king himself. Harold now knew that his army was weakened and that every fighting man would be required to hold the hill. That would include two of his brothers, his son, and perhaps even his lover, Edith Swan Neck. The Norman orcs kept coming, little waves bent on probing the wall for weakness,
stay behind this shield.
Listen to me.
Stay behind this shield.
Watch him. I want no more charges.
Upon hour, the Normans threw themselves upon the shield wall, determined to bombard the English from all sides. And then, most decisively,
crossbows! Position!
From above and below in the same volley.
Archers! Draw!
Detail it came to pass that the Normans prevailed on that day at Hastings will forever be shrouded in blood mist. What is known for sure is that by dusk, the invaders finally broke the shield wall for good and poured through. And after defeating the mighty Vikinger and running the length of our country, not once, but twice, the exhausted farmers of Angolan stood little chance. The fate of our warrior king remains unclear to this day. Some gaze upon the conqueror's famed cloth of Bayeux and see him slain by an arrow to the eye. Harold the King is killed, it says. But others say that he is this bloodied figure lain low by a horseman. That four Norman knights, crazed with bloodlust, beset the body of the kingship, disemboweled him, gelded him, and then beheaded him.
Oh!
The Norman Orca left 5,000 Englishmen unburied upon Senlac Hill for 10 long years. And within a lifetime, not a single hide of Sussex had an English owner.
There is some pleasant land up where we came ashore. Good fields. Good rivers. We can settle there. How many sons do we have?
Six.
We will have land for another time. Woman!
Harold alone was permitted a burial. And so the tribute goes, you rest here, Harold that was a king, that you still may guard the shore and sea. We do not despise you, kingship, but we grieve and mourn for you. England was never the same again. The priories could not remain a refuge forever. And after more unkindnesses too cruel to be related, the wife men of the south were set to making the story that would be told. Thus shining great light upon the Duke who became William, the conqueror of our precious piece of Middle-earth. Now I've reached the end of the bitter sorrow of my child days. Our village of Crowhurst became the home of others who meant to stay. Our families would never again bring in the barley. We set to wandering in search of a new home. And it had once been told to me that to soothe my child fear, perhaps, that the way to the West is a place rightly renowned, a remote part of Middle-earth, where the land is so lovely, endowed with delights, and Earth's sweetest scents.